Okay, Mohan Krishna did Information and Communication Technology from Shastra University.
Yes, sir.
And then you did M.Tech, right?
Yes, sir.
M.Tech from?
IIT Bombay.
IIT Bombay. Okay. Your optional is Political Science.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Mohan Krishna.
Sir.
You said you write emails to editors, authors and government functionaries.
Sir.
Tell me, to whom did you write?
Sir, for government functionaries,
I
can tell the example where I have written to Andhra Pradesh Education Secretary about introducing coding, basic coding as part of curriculum of plus one and plus two students.
Mm-hmm.
So, which is what I have observed in Tamil Nadu. Mm-hmm. Where they have basic C and C++ coding as part of their curriculum in plus one and plus two, which gives them an advantage in a job market and which creates an interest for the people, for the students in basic coding. So that is my observation, and based on which I had written to then Education Secretary of Andhra Pradesh. And another example could be where I have written again to Education Secretary that Telugu as a subject should be made mandatory from 1st standard to 12th standard in state syllabus. So, and when it comes to editors, I frequently write to The Hindu, which the newspaper that I follow the most. So, in case I like some articles where they have presented a good viewpoint, I will write to the author of the article if the email is provided. Otherwise, I will write my comments to the editor.
Are some of them published?
Sir, not in The Hindu, sir. In a regional newspaper, Inadu. One comment has been published, sir.
Okay. But what is the purpose of writing like that?
Sorry, sir.
What is the purpose of writing?
Writing to
something like government functionary.
Sir, my intention is to...
Do you think they really care about such letters?
Sir, firstly, I have got some responses initially. So, in both examples that I have quoted, I have received a positive response, but that was not followed up in on-ground action. However, I believe that as a responsible citizen, it is my duty that if I have some suggestions or policy inputs that I want to give to the government, that I should play my role as such.
Did you use RTI for any purpose?
Yes, sir. I have used RTI once during 2014, sir. It was in 2014. Sorry, sir. I have used it twice. It was in 2014 for the first time to understand what exactly the special category status entails. And that was the time when there was a demand for special category status for Andhra Pradesh. So, I wanted to know whether special category status in itself entails economic incentives that are being set politically then. And second time I have filed an RTI to UPSC in 2017 to get the state-wise breakup of vacancies. So these are the only two instances I have.
So you got the response?
Yes, sir. Both the times I have got a response, sir.
How should RTI be improved?
So, firstly, with respect to the at the union level, RTI implementation is much better in my opinion. There is a portal RTI online, which makes it very easy for someone who wants to file an RTI, which is not the case at the state level. There are no portals and the process is cumbersome. Secondly, the appointments at state level, including the higher positions of Chief Information Commissioner, and information commissioners, so there are so many vacancies, including in my state.
Recently, some changes are made to the status of information commissioners. What do you know about them?
Sir, earlier they were at par with election commissioners, and by equivalence, they will be at par with the judges of Supreme Court, which is not the case after the amendment. Secondly, in appointments, central government will have a more say in appointments and that tenure of the information commissioners.
In tenure?
Yes, sir.
Central. Are these good measures?
So, firstly, with regards to the bringing down their status from being at par with election commission, I don't think it is right for the reason that information commissioners have to be independent.
Okay.
They cannot be expecting some sanctions or incentives from the government for their actions.
Mm.
Because RTI is considered as a watchdog law for the governance.
Okay.
And with respect to second thing, I believe that is again not a good move because it interferes into the state government powers, which is against the spirit of cooperative federalism.
But why does government want to do such things?
So the reason they have cited is that information commissioners cannot be at par with Supreme Court judges. They they are appointed for a specific period. They are not from within the government hierarchy. And secondly, sir, with regards to having a say in appointments, I do not see any fundamental rationale which is being advanced by them.
Okay. Okay. Tell me, what do you think is the most important relevance of Gandhi for today's world politics?
Relevance of
Gandhi. Gandhiji.
Gandhi. So first is non-violence.
So why is it so relevant?
Because we are so globalized today that in the interconnected world we cannot afford another war, another world war or any war. We are seeing the impacts in the Middle East where the economy is shattered and people's lives are at utter dismay. There is millions of refugees from Syria and entire Middle East, MENA region, that is.
How is that related to war?
So it is because of the war-torn area, that Syria, Iraq is the war-torn area for the past, nearly past two decades. And that has caused...
How did it become war-prone?
So firstly, with respect to Iraq, USA has declared a war on then Iraq regime led by Mr. Saddam Hussein on the pretext that they are developing nuclear weapons.
You mean those wars created problems in that region?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So that created a sort of anarchy in Iraq, which in turn paved way for rise of non-state actors like.
But then, don't you think that was response to terrorism?
Sir, actually, that paved way for terrorism.
How did you mean war led to 9/11? Or 9/11 led to war?
No, I'm saying like after 9/11, the action was initiated in Afghanistan in first place.
Okay.
Secondly, this is in 2003, they went for a war against Iraq.
So, terrorism led to war?
That is in Afghanistan, sir.
That's true, but after that, Iraq?
So, Iraq primarily on the pretext of then government making nuclear weapons was the main reason why
they... Not related to 9/11.
Not related to 9/11.
But I think America said it was also related to 9/11.
Sorry, sir?
It was also related to 9/11.
Sorry, sir. As far as I know, it
is fine on
that ground.
Okay, fine.
And the war itself led to anarchy and there is no single stable government in Iraq, which paved way for rise of Islamic State. And then...
So you meant to say wars led to?
Wars have created...
If Gandhi is followed, there won't be a war.
Yes, sir. That is the single most important contribution that we can have.
But how can one say that there won't be, there shouldn't be wars?
There should be utmost restraint in going for the war. War should not be the first or second option. It can only be the last option when nothing else works.
Mm.
And secondly, sir, with the...
Okay. Please.
Secondly, his views on being... Living in consonance with the environment is something that we need to adopt right now as we are staring at climate change and we have recognized the harmful effects of climate change. So that point of his concern.
Now tell me, between 1 and 2, which is more relevant?
So I believe both are relevant, but if I have to pick one, then I would pick climate change because wars are something that we create. And climate change is already happening, so that needs to be tackled as well. So if I have to pick one, I will pick climate change.
Okay. But how is Gandhi relevant to climate change?
Sir, his life, he led...
He didn't know that there would be like something like global warming.
Yes, sir.
Hmm.
But the life he led was so environmental friendly and... Hmm. He said that the current pace of industrialization, of the if we follow the Western model, if the entire globe follows the Western model, we would be requiring 9 more Earths to satisfy the needs. So What I mean to say is that the model of industrialization that we have followed over the past two centuries or so has put immense stress on the environment.
Now tell me, on these two counts, to what extent India is following Gandhi?
On the first count of war, we have always refrained to the maximum possible extent from the war.
Mm.
There were never any offensive wars from Indian sides to capture territory, or there was never an offensive move. It was only in defense, the wars that we have fought in earlier.
Very interesting. Which country went to war as an offense rather than defense? Anyway, is there any country which had offense department?
For example, I can quote Pakistan, sir.
Pakistan?
Yes, sir.
It has offense department.
Yes, sir. No, offensively, they went war for 1999. It was their provocation which has started the war. Their occupation of Indian posts in Kargil area is the cause of the war at that point of time. So that I say as an offensive.
But they claim that area is theirs.
No, but there is this.
So they may take, that is the effort to take back the land.
Sir, but that there is an internationally agreed norm that line of control has become the agreed boundary for time being. Till the final settlement is made, we have to abide by this line of control, which they have breached. That I would say as
an offensive. Okay. Apart from India, can you name other countries which have gone for war, not for offense, not for defense purpose, but for offense purposes?
Sir, we can go back in history and say Germany under Hitler has went for offensive. It wanted to expand the territorial expanse of Germany.
Mm. But that again was the response to World War One.
Yes, sir. But
this land was taken by others.
Yes, sir. But there was no reason to be offensive, sir. They could have been within their territory. They wanted to take some land from Czechoslovakia, from Poland. They even wanted to enter Russia and take some of the territories of Russia.
That's true, but it was hurt so badly.
Yes, sir.
So it wanted to take revenge.
Yes, sir.
So that's what it was doing. So probably there is nothing like offense and defense. People are both.
Sir.
You don't think so? For example, how do you explain that no country in the world has an offense department?
So there will be offensive department, but
was there an offense department anywhere in the world?
There will be offensive policy as a counter to as one of the tools of strategy, sir.
Mm.
But if we look at the history, India has not undertaken any offensive operation. That is what I meant to convey, sir.
Mm-hmm. How about other countries? No, you mean to say other countries are offensive, but India is purely defensive. That is what you are saying.
There are examples of countries which have gone offensive.
Mm.
And as I quoted few examples, like Pakistan or Saudi Arabia in Yemen, what it is doing. These are few examples where they have went offensive. But what I wanted to convey here again is that India has never undertaken such an offensive operation.
Okay, next. How far India followed Gandhi, second dimension?
Sir, on the environment front, I believe that we are making some moves towards addressing this climate change, both mitigation and adaptation.
Mm.
Whether the moves would be enough or not is questionable, because we also have the developmental objectives that need to be balanced with environmental concerns. However,
so in both the cases, we are following Gandhi.
Yes, sir, to some extent, we are following Gandhiism.
Whereas the world is not following to any extent.
No, sir. Because there is a Paris deal. Many other countries have also made commitments towards climate change. We can say that the world has taken note of the relevance of being environmentally
responsible. Tell me, how about making Guntur as Andhra Pradesh capital?
Guntur as a city will not be feasible because it already has been an unplanned city, which has grown in many directions without any proper organization.
Mm.
So if it is made capital city, it is likely that it would burgeon in many more directions without proper urban planning.
Mm.
And secondly, the Amaravati, which as of now is the capital of Andhra Pradesh, is very 25 kilometers away from the Guntur city.
So it is as good as making Guntur as the capital?
Yes, sir. Because Amaravati is a greenfield capital.
Tell me, are you personally beneficiary of Amaravati as a capital?
Personally, yes, sir.
How?
the land prices have shot up after declaration of Amravati as the capital.
How are you benefited?
Because my father owns some land in that area.
Okay.
The prices have shot up.
So that's why you oppose shifting of the capital to Vizag?
No, sir. That is not the reason why I oppose that.
Mm.
The primary reason is that there should be some logistical convenience for various organs of the government to communicate so as to achieve coherence in governance. So if there are three different places, the three organs of government at three different places, it would be difficult for them to communicate and it would make the hardships of people even more.
But why is the government doing this?
Sir, the stated intent is that by decentralizing, what they term as decentralization of capital, it will help in decentralization of development, but which is not necessarily the case. I can cite the examples of, from USA, we can take the example of New York, where the capital is Alba City, whereas the most famous financial capital is New York City. So there is no direct correlation between where the governance city is
and last question.
Development.
Sir. Tell me, what is the difference between separation of powers and decentralization?
Sir, separation of
powers versus decentralization of power.
Sir, separation of powers is at horizontal level between three organs of the government, judiciary, legislature and executive. That one should not encroach into the sphere of other and they should work independently as a mechanism of check and balance.
Mm. And when did this separation of powers concept come and who gave it?
Sir, Montesquieu is attributed to having given this separation of power theory during French Revolution.
Okay.
Mm. And decentralization is vertical devolution of powers, wherein the second and third tiers of government would get more powers, functions and funds for them to undertake effective developmental works.
Okay. So how do you judge Andhra Pradesh capital plan? Is it decentralization or separation?
It is just a dispersal or extension of the various organs of government. It is not decentralization.
It is nor separation.
Nor is it separation. So it is not altering any power structures as of now. It is only shifting the location of governance.
Good. Yes. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
How do you feel? Okay, in terms of answers. What do you say, Murali Krishna? About his interview. Anything else? Mithun, what are your observations? Okay, my judgment is that your answers are good in general, but you are scared of criticizing India. That's where you spoiled. See, I hold patriotism is an ugly thing, but that has nothing to do with the interview. I am talking about performance in the interview. Look at India critically. What prevents you from looking at India critically? The whole world is not following Gandhi, but India is following Gandhi. But I am asking you, the world should learn, the world. But how about India? About the world, fine. I am asking you, to what extent Gandhi is followed in India? What prevents you from saying we are not following? That what are all these nuclear weapons, policies, foreign policy failures? And then, just take time, please. Every country has the Department of Defense, which means the country thinks it is defending. It is the other country which thinks the other country is being offending. No country thinks it is offending. Isn't it so? Why countries have defense departments? That simple point you are not catching. Why do countries have defense department and not an offense department? Because people believe that they are only defending. So every person is taught to believe that his country is superior. Isn't it so? You can say that. please think about it. So countries believe that they are only defending, but that is not the way their enemies think so. That's how things are. Whereas you think you are being objective by saying that India is a great country and other countries are not. I don't know, I want you to think about it. Then we are in such an environmental mess, and you say we are doing okay, we have to take care of developmental needs. Then where is Gandhi? Then why should others follow Gandhi then? If India has to balance, then the world also has to balance. Then why do you say that in the world has to follow? But India doesn't have to. Then war and peace also have to be balanced. How can you oppose war? No, please take time. There are two things. What are your views and what is your interview answer? I believe you look without any fear when it comes to the world. But when it comes to India, frightened. I don't know, think about it. I mean, this is the general problem. They are bold, clear when they talk about the world. Ask a simple question on India, collapse. That's why his interview is different. He's open. Clear, frank. I was shocked. I first thought maybe you have a problem in saying India could be offensive. But then you have a problem in talking about climate change also. You are not in a position to say these models may be wrong. You are not even saying may be wrong. You are just repeating government's viewpoint. Think about it. I mean, there are two issues. That is the way you yourself think, or that is the way you think you should speak. Two issues. Okay. But I believe as long as you are not saying anything anti-constitutional, you can criticize. And criticism leads to good interview. You are missing occasions where the interview quality could have been pushed. offense and defense. So each country thinks it is defending its interests, but others will have a different perspective. That's all. Very simple. Sir, given agricultural crisis, farmers crisis, air pollution, it is very clear we did not follow Gandhism. That makes a good interview. So your answers were good when I was asking about the world, but a fraction of that boldness, fraction of that intelligence is killed by this patriotism. Just say, no, we have not followed. This is a tragedy. This is not good. When there are more critical questions, you can say, I have not thought of. That's all. Don't repeat a government policy. The idea that we have to have a balance is just a very, very bad answer. Climate change showed that our image of development itself is wrong. That is not the way to develop. And that is where Gandhi comes. He had a different dream of development. When you say relevance of Gandhi, you are rejecting the dream of development. And when you reject the dream of development, you can't say we have to develop and prioritize this. Please think. If they are your strong convictions, then that is different. But it is a matter of your perception that you cannot be critical of India, then I don't think that makes a good strategy. In fact, you be critical, and then in a discussion, if you need to moderate, you moderate. First, raise the discussion. Then that becomes consistent, clear. Okay, he has some ideas. We listen. Say this model is wrong. Why do you think so? Don't you need to balance? Then you can say, yes, something is needed. Take a clear statement. And especially when you said so clearly about the world, why do you have to say this about India? So try to look at the world, try to look at India broadly, critically, generate a discussion. And have a conversation. Not this kind of a defensive attitude. You can't make me say anything bad about India. Because your selection is good, the way you identified Gandhi's relevance. And then I was even shocked when you said, between climate change and non-violence, you chose climate change. Yes, it calls for insight. That is good. But you extend that insight to India also. Why are you scared? I don't know, that is my reading, you work out. In his interview, there is consistency, clarity, fearlessness, it is like that. Transparently he comes out. Okay. You please think about it. It doesn't mean you should literally follow. I expect. But I give you particular feedback so that you will work on it and find out your own way of responding. Anything else? When is your interview? Wow, you have enough time. And I don't think you need to worry about this pace and things like that. It's good. I don't know how you spoke at other places, but you don't have any problem with pace. Just one second, we'll see where he is, Dheeraj. Dheeraj vastunnada? I'll give you this. Lectures on Andhra Pradesh economy, you please read. Rajnikant, the lecture, AP economy books. I gave that book to you. Okay. To you? Okay. I'll just write. Murali Krishna Mahakrishna. So, critical approach helps, that raises the discussion. And then if you think maybe I took not so justifiable stand, then you moderate. But first get their attention, raise the discussion. So how far we followed Gandhi raises the discussion by so many times. By just giving a standard narrative, you're just diluting it. Just take a stand, then they will ask. Take a critical look, especially when you know the topic, not when you don't know the topic. Take a critical look, then raises the quality. If you're taking the governmental positions, it won't help. And I don't think you need to change in anything else. Okay? We'll work out. Bye. Thank you.